Welcome to the first video presentation of Tweet Editing. I'm Katie Van Heest, PhD, the academic editor behind Tweet. And in this video, I'm going to take you behind the scenes of my own dissertation process and I distill a series of steps that you too will have to take as you revise your own dissertation. I suggest that you view this presentation in full screen mode because I've packed a lot of information onto each slide. Everything I describe in this presentation reflects my experience with revising my own dissertation. But while every project is different, I do hope that the method I used is likewise useful to you. Only somebody familiar with your work can actually give you precise feedback regarding its argument and structure. So to incorporate the potentially contradictory feedback of your advisors, your peers, your editors, anybody whose thoughts you've solicited, you have to have a method for self-revision. Keeping your own goals for the project in mind, I suggest that you approach your material on your own terms and only after you've set it and others' feedback aside for a while so that you achieve some distance. Now let's move forward. In this video, I'm describing the steps I took between submitting a full first draft to my committee and then later the defense draft. So if you're smart, you'll actually do this revising before the committee sees anything. After I sent my first full draft to my committee, I didn't look at what I'd written for like a month or two. And once I received their reports, though, I kind of had to just dive right back in. So I perused each chapter and assessed the state of things. I found that the quotes I'd used really dictated the structure. My own argument was less pronounced than I would have liked, and I seemed to be kind of like hopping from quote to quote. I knew I had something to say, but I was leaning too heavily on the words of others. Similarly, I'd paraphrased the background of my research from other sources, and it seemed forcibly inserted into the chapters instead of naturally arising as it suited my argument. I did have lengthy stretches of analysis, but overall I could see that it was poorly organized, which was okay because this was just my first full draft. Before moving forward with my own revisions, I skimmed my committee members' comments, and if you haven't had your committee take a look at it yet, it could just be anybody's comments or your own thoughts as you were rereading or whatever. And in my case, I knew that my committee members were pointing to weak spots of the argument, but I also knew that I couldn't address their concerns until I reconnected with what motivated me and my argument. So my readers' approaches actually really complemented one another. One of them zoomed in on like fundamental problems in my argument, another pointed to the need for clarification and some additional research on a really specific part of my dissertation, and the other just took me on a tour through all of the superficial flaws that remained in this early draft. And they each did a little bit of all three of those different levels of feedback, but I did find that their different emphases complemented one another. At this point, I was thinking about how overwhelming their excellent feedback was and how fuzzy my writing really was when seen in that light. So I needed a concrete way to just get in there and start working with my words. I pulled from my training in developmental editing and I decided to dissect each chapter. I read through a printout of my material and I noted every new subject in the margins. That means that every time I changed subjects, I had to flag the change and then label the new topic. A subject could be expressed in a sentence, a paragraph, or even multiple pages, but I didn't assume that the sections as I had divided them in the first draft were coherent. I was actually on the lookout for random 1 to 2 sentence tangents that might be better placed elsewhere. And they might not be, I just wanted to flag them so I could deal with them. At the same time, I underlined every sentence or clause that sounded like a thesis, a subthesis, or just a good distillation of my argument. And I didn't make any distinctions between those three kinds of things. I just labeled anything that seemed like an argument thesis. I then typed up a list of all the subjects that I covered chapter by chapter, and then a separate list for all my theses, again, chapter by chapter. So I ended up with at least 2 dozen theses and twice as many subjects. some theses and subjects recurred instead of being in any one place. Again, that's not necessarily bad, and not necessarily going to change that, but it was important for me to be aware. Next, I looked at my list of theses and tried to see how they related. You might call this mind mapping, and there's actually software programs out there that can help you with this, but I've read that we engage a totally different part of our brains when we work with pen and paper, so I actually suggest that method, you know, writing things down with a writing implement. That way you tap into your most creative abilities for this process. My goal was to create a hierarchy of these little arguments so that they built on one another and weren't all given equal weight within the overall project. I knew I needed one cohesive thesis for the whole project and then sub-theses for each chapter, which in turn, you know, had several points to argue. So if no thesis happened to become top dog for any chapter, as they were written in these lists, then I would write a new umbrella thesis that tied together all of the little theses for that chapter. Some theses became so insignificant to the overall plot that was coming to light that I jettisoned them. I ended up with an argument-driven outline for the whole dissertation, and the linkages between all those newly ordered theses and sub-theses were yet to be worked out. I then took a look at a list of my subjects, which I created at the same time that I listed all the theses. Chapter by chapter, I played with the ordering of subjects. I kept an open mind as to what would work best to get my points across, and these were the points that I had delineated in my argument-driven outline. I ended up with better chunked topics, but I also knew that some of the transitions I had so carefully crafted in my first draft would have to fall by the wayside. And I just tried to put that concern aside. I mean, I really liked how I had worded some of those transitions, but I just needed to move forward. And that's my refrain today. Just move forward. The next step was, of course, copying and pasting material into the new argument-driven order that I'd outlined. So I actually started a new document at this point. I put the old document on one side of my computer screen and the new document on the other side. I highlighted and pulled text from the old to the new. At this point, I also crafted some transitions that would segue from topic to topic. I had to remove some of those well-written linkages that had held together the previous draft. But the last thing you want in a new draft is to start a paragraph or section with a segue from the topic that used to precede it. And that's something that can travel from draft to draft until you at one point get enough distance from your own writing to notice. So try to be aware of it. I found that the new transitions were actually easy to write because the argument motivated them and it all just felt natural. In composing those transitions, it also became clear that I needed to find support for some of my points. And I then just did that research. It was all in books and articles that I'd already accessed and notes that I'd already taken. And after I did that, I knew that I had wrangled my source material far more effectively and actually had thorough discussions of each topic that I touched upon. Feeling very accomplished, I then reprinted each chapter as I had reorganized it, and I read it with structure and flow in mind, making broad adjustments along the way so that my argument was basically as clear as I could make it. I also cut examples that seemed extraneous, and I challenged myself to paraphrase every single quote. Obviously, I didn't end up summarizing all of the quotations that I'd used, but I realized that if I could easily paraphrase a quote, then I probably should. and that helped my voice come through much more strongly. I was in control of my source material instead of the other way around. I also tightened my transitions yet again and wrote section headings that reflected how my argument built rather than just the topics that I had covered. Remember those committee comments that I looked over before embarking on this revision? At this point is when I revised them, and I took each reader's feedback separately and verified that I had addressed every concern that they raised. this step actually took a long time because although I was in a much better place with this new draft, I still hadn't fixed everything that they pointed out. But by systematically going through and checking off each point of feedback as I addressed it, I showed that I appreciated and took into account the advice that these mentors had generously given me. My dissertation is so much better as a result. As an academic editor, I knew I'd like the next step, which is polishing up the draft by copy editing. My committee let me know that my dissertation was much cleaner than others they'd seen, but I know I still, you know, messed up a few conjugations, pronoun antecedent pairs, and even word choice. It's just really hard to catch everything when you're copy editing your own work. And if you feel or have been advised that your writing could be more refined, you might consider enlisting the help of a professional academic editor at this point. With the draft revised from the ground up, I then sent the defense draft along to my committee, knowing that I had made leaps and bounds since my previous version and that the end of the project was in sight. And I realized that I've just set out a many-phased method for revision. As I said before, I just hope that it's in some way useful to you. You may take these steps in a different order, but you probably will have to go through them all, you know, regardless of whether you name them the way I do or are conscious of them. Just decide what's best for you and your dissertation and move forward. And I'd love it if you let me know how it goes. My email is katie@tweededing.com. For free guides and tools to help you revise, see the blog post announcing this video. It's at http://tweededing.com/2011/07/revising. Those resources include a guide to academic style, a long list of academic verbs to use as synonyms, or different permutations of argue and state and all of those words we get in a rut of using. They also include a cover sheet for soliciting critique from those outside your official committee, perhaps, and the opportunity to sign up for my newsletter, which I try to pack with content for you. So thank you for watching, and remember, just move forward.